Hey everyone, suppose a girl had lived all her life in a black and white room. Let's call her Mary. She had a TV, but that too was black and white. She has never seen colors in her life, though she has heard of people talking about it on the TV. The concept of color was completely foreign to her, but brilliant and alone as she was determined to unravel this mystery of colors. And so, she acquired every bit of knowledge there was to know about the workings of the brain, the complex particle interactions and how it leads to a sensation of colors, the physics, chemistry, biology governing it, everything. With such a great wealth of knowledge, when she would have gone out of her room in an environment filled with colors, would she have learned something new, something about the inner experience of finally feeling colors? Or would her new experience only confirm what she had figured out way earlier while she was trying to understand how the brain creates the image of colors? What do you think? Our brains are so good at painting a picture of the external reality that we often mistake it for being real and fundamental. When you see a color, there's something that you see that just can't be described. Well, you can describe its physical form. A color is nothing but a particular wavelength of light. But when we see colors, we don't deal with numbers. Rather, we see them. Red has redness. What's redness? Well, I can't describe that to someone who can't see red. But for someone who can see red, it makes all the sense in the world. These features of our subjective experience that can't be described to others, like what does it feel like to see red, to smell the morning, or listening to golden hour, are called qualia. A famous analogy comes from Thomas Nagel, where he asks, what does it feel like to be a bat? We can describe what it does, you know, how it hunts its prey, or what it eats, or how it may communicate. But can we understand the first-person perspective of being a bat? The inner feelings that a bat experiences, which most likely would be quite different to how a human experiences. Bats are known to use echolocation to decipher what's around them, just like how we use light. And similar to how light creates a mental image inside of us, bats probably also create some sort of echolocation colors. These mental states present a gap in our understanding of consciousness. It is simple enough to think about how humans might use light to navigate around, but the inner mental representation of light inside our head lacks an explanation. This is the explanatory gap. Things like color, smell, or taste aren't present in the outside world. Rather, they are mental construct that takes shape inside our brains, based on information from the outside world. And that is what Anil Sheth calls controlled hallucinations, implying a type of illusion that is controlled in a sense that it makes sense and is generally accepted between many individuals, and is also productive in terms of survival. While normal hallucinations being when these illusions go out of control and have nothing to do with the external reality. Filling the explanatory gap would be to understand how those subjective experiences could originate from simple brain processes. In this sense, the world as we see it is something really personal, and thus it raises many philosophical issues. For example, can we tell that the world as we see it is the same as everybody else sees it? For all the cases, what looks red to you may look to someone else as what looks to you as green. Confusing? Well, let's try another one. Suppose sometime in the far future, while you are trying to talk to an advanced chatbot, it confesses to be conscious. Would you just believe it? Because technically you can't actually verify that it's conscious. All the things it does are governed by determined algorithms. Where does consciousness come from? When we think about ourselves, in addition to all the things that we do, there's a personal identity, a you that's thinking underneath somewhere, an inner experience of being present, aware, and conscious. But how do you know others have the same properties? No, I'm not talking about the things that someone can do, but rather their being and inner self, something that you know you have. But does everybody else have it? Because it is pretty conceivable to replicate all of human functions without there being consciousness. And this is the problem of being philosophical zombies. For all behavioral purposes, it acts surprisingly like a normal human, but lacks consciousness. For example, if you pinch such a human, it would probably slap you. But not because it felt the pain. No, rather it can't actually experience anything. But rather, this is how its particles react to what you did, without there being an inner self. And that is also related to what's called the problem of other minds. The fact that so far, we can't tell if others also have a subjective experience and an inner self. And so, for all you know, I may not be conscious, but I actually am, just so you know. Trust me. So where does it all bring us in terms of what would happen in Mary's case? Can a complete knowledge lead her to directly understanding the feeling of subjective experience? Or is it something that requires a first-person experience? When Mary would see the colors for the first time, what would that encounter be like? The thing is, the explanatory gap may not be a gap in the fundamental workings of reality. It might just be a gap in our understanding. And who knows, she might have found a way of seeing colors that does not require eyes, debatable as it might be. We have already made significant advances in understanding what brain processes are responsible for certain body functions. When somebody feels pain, we can see specific regions in the brain to light up, while happiness stimulates another set of brain signals. When you give a smile after someone helps you out, well, in theory, we can trace that behavior bit by bit in the signals flowing from your brain to your mouth muscles ending up in a smile. However, the hard problem is to understand how this neural behavior leads to a conscious mind. What makes that feeling of joy possible? How do some trillions of particle interactions form something like subjective experience? There are many other systems that display outlandish complexity. Tornadoes, traffic jams, stock exchange, all of these emerge from the behaviors of the underlying constituents. When many cars are stuck in a particular way, we call it a traffic jam. But in theory, there's nothing puzzling about them. Because, well, there's no such thing as what it feels like to be a traffic jam. These systems don't have subjective experience. We do. Now, the stream of consciousness that we are aware of can turn out to be something that just comes up when a whole bunch of information units work together. However, so far, we just don't know how that might be happening. And even though these qualities of the mind seem almost mystical, it's likely that an explanation would be well within the domains of science. At any instance, our brains are bombarded with information from the external world. Our subjective experience may then be a way our brains make sense of the world by ignoring details that don't matter and creating their own little worldview that maximizes their chance of survival. And of course, we don't know if any of this is true or how consciousness comes into being, or even why is it even possible. Time will tell. Or perhaps Mary. Thanks for watching. Bye.